And we are back, guys. This is the third game of a best of five. Energy Pacemaker versus Tong Fu. It's 1-1 at the moment, so we have at least, minimum, two more games to come. They really make it exciting. They don't just run through with a 3-0, obviously. We had previous games, and it was always close. We have to see if Tong Fu has the upper hand as the favorite team, of course, because they ran through the winner bracket relatively flawless. They just gave here and there some games away, even around Robin. Out of seven games, they just dropped one. It's the ESCC, for those who just joined the stream. It's a 40,000 USD Chinese tournament for tier 2 teams, pretty much. It's a very nice content so far. I enjoyed it, even though it's very, very long and very exhausting. So forgive the insanity or lack of sanity from time to time. We're really struggling here in the heat. It doesn't matter. With me is Mr. Blackadder. Let's go into this draft. Let's enjoy this game. Two more to come. And yeah, don't forget also, guys, at 17 CEST, there's also the game show starting for CL versus Burden. So I hope till then we are done, but it's very, very unlikely. It's going to overlap, which is kind of too bad, but well, we will see.
Well, let's get this draft underway and avoid your insanity, shall we? Clockwork banned, Tusk gone, Storm Spirit exiled, and Shadow Fiend sent back to hell. First pick, Leshrac, no surprises. Then we go for Rubick and a Gyrocopter. This seems to be pretty standard throughout this tournament so far. But now, well, let's go into the next pick for Energy Pacemaker. And Queen of Pain would be nice, although I'm expecting an Earthshaker.
Yep, absolutely. So, Earthshaker, yes. What else is there? The Undying would be there. The Bar would be there if they really want to get it in. The Tusk is this time out again, as well as the Clockwork. It's kind of interesting that Energy Pacemaker always kind of favorites at least one of those potential offliners or those roamers. Like, they definitely don't like this. Very interesting is also that Tong Fu, all the time, they banned out the Drow, and thanks to that, Energy Pacemaker was able to pick, for example, the Storm, and the Storm had, I wouldn't say a blast in this game, but he was a key role initiation. I think many fights came really down to the fact that the Orchid really was the MVP, the sixth player, especially on the Anti-Mage, made a lot of ganks possible where they ran out of stuns. We had pretty much the same on the Broodmother, but the Broodmother, I don't know, these Broodmothers at the moment that get picked, they just don't get into the game. So we get a Dazzle and relatively fast bans right after.
There'll be no Visage, Zeus, Beastmaster, and most likely I should think a ban on either the Winter Wyvern or, more importantly, the Drow, considering we know what Energy Pacemaker can do with the Drow, and they've already got two range heroes. Will not surprise me, per se, considering who they crushed. They crushed Newbie Youth with the Drow lineup, didn't they?
Yes.
Yeah, the best three before this one.
Yeah, both of their Drow, Drow Ranger games, they actually won. It was the non-BKB Drow that really just went for stats and lifesteal and then just racked through everything for some reason. They really protected them. It was a full protect one strategy, pretty much with one core that was more of an initiator, and it worked out. So this time, in theory, could even see the Drow is still in the mix.
Well, with the possibility for a Drow for Energy Pacemaker, if they were to get the Drow, the Visage is banned out, so that combination won't be there, but they could go for that five range hero, we're going to just shatter your towers and morale kind of push. It worked before, and the Pugna isn't banned out, and that's very key to this. Flip side of the coin, however, Tong Fu will ban out the Earthshaker and pick themselves up the Phoenix. Well, we've seen how much work the Phoenix can do.
Yes, I think this is jealousy drafting right here, isn't it? Because Energy Pacemaker had amazing games with the Phoenix, and Tong Fu is like, you know what? We can do the same, but wow, Bounty Hunter coming out. We haven't had a Bounty Hunter in quite a while. When we had it in, I think, the last time I saw the Bounty Hunter here in this tournament was yesterday, end of round robin. We had some games with the Bounty Hunter. I think it was a bit up and down with him. Not every game really worked out, but of course, here's the chance. The only thing I don't like is, of course, the Bounty Hunter is not the greatest damage source to begin with. The Dazzle is also, first of all, just used mostly for the healing, the lane presence, and pulling. So, yeah, the Rubick, I don't know, it does more. So does the Phoenix, so does the Gyrocopter. They have to draft something with more early game potential, in my opinion, right now.
Quite possibly, yes. And you want early game potential? There's your Pugna. So this could actually be quite heavy on the push as well. considering the strength of the Nether Blast. Now, I very much like this kind of combination as well, since you can throw Phoenix in, Pugna hits the Decrep on a target, that target gets Fade Bolted, and it just goes downhill from there. But this, for Energy Pacemaker, just got very, very long-winded, I think, in terms of the game plan. That's a Phantom Lancer, and in all honesty, these games tend to go longer when there's a Phantom Lancer involved.
Yep, absolutely. Phantom Lancer, does it mean we get a Coddle ban right now? The Coddle would be overkill, wouldn't it? Be like, it would be double heal then with the Arcanum Scepter and everything. Nah, that's not coming out. I kind of doubt that. Then again, it's Chinese Dota, you never know. I was kind of, except for the starter picks, there's a lot of things that, I don't know, like, sometimes are so off and so exciting. On the other hand, well, they banned the Coddle. They had the same fear, I guess, I had. And on the other side, we're gonna see the Viper, which I can understand. Not playing against the Viper, that's fine, because Phantom Lancer struggles against it. The Leshrac, of course, is a hero that struggles very much against the Viper because of the natural tankiness of Corrosive Skin. So yeah, I can totally live with this, but they need to take care of that Phantom Lancer.
They do, and honestly, against a PL, some good form of AoE damage to distinguish and kill off the illusions is one way of playing it. The other is to go mana warfare against a Phantom Lancer. Hell, something that can actually work quite well against a Phantom Lancer that we haven't seen in quite a while, OD.
Okay.
As long as the Phantom Lancer doesn't get out of control in terms of a Diffusal Blade, if OD comes in and drops the Sanity, Phantom Lancer is just a smear on the floor. That's it.
So if OD Pixel comes in and drops his Insanity, then everything's fine for Tung Fu Ether.
I get enough Insanity from you. I don't need you having a teammate.
A cast with OD Pixel would actually be kind of funny, I guess. Especially when I have such a marathon and I'm a bit gaga in my hoo-hoo place. Like, underneath my skull.
A bit.
Anyway, the Queen of Pain. I was about to say this because look at the bans. And one thing that has been forgotten pretty much the last two games is the Queen of Pain. She was kind of falling off the roster. Now she's in there. That means we have the Heavy Magic Burst. We have the Sonic Wave pursing even through BKBs, which is going to be a problem for the Lashback. He's going to definitely run a BKB in this one sooner or later. And that with a Gyrocopter, that's tons of AoE. Not to mention we have the Egg, the Fate Ball, and the Nether Blast, plus a ward to fight against. So in those clutch fights, I would definitely say Energy Pacemaker, they struggle a lot.
I got to admit, Energy Pacemaker, they are on the back foot right now. Queen of Pain, another brilliant source of AoE damage. Pure as well to go through any kind of BKBs with the ultimate. This is going to be quite nasty for Energy Pacemaker, but it was actually called out in the chat, so respect whoever said it first. Nortrum would work very well here for Energy Pacemaker.
Silencer. Yeah. It would be nice, of course, if the Silent comes out before the Queen of Pain can do anything. Of course, also, if you chase the Queen of Pain and you can kill the Phoenix before he actually does something. But then again, you already have a Dazzle, you have a Bounty Hunter, squishy targets that are easily taken out. They do not survive those clash fights for a very long time. And the Silencer is just adding something on top. And the timing has to be just perfect. It's a possibility. I'm not saying it's impossible, but I'm kind of afraid that would be just too squishy and too easy of a game, especially for Queen of Pain, for a Gyrocopter AoE. 25 minutes, 30 minutes plus, it's not going to work out. We're going to see a Nyx Assassin with the Leshrac on the same side. Usually Nyx Assassin is the one you pick against the Leshrac.
Well, to be fair, a Nyx is a pretty damn good choice as well. If he goes in to an enemy fight and Gyrocopter's sat there spamming the flat cannon, doesn't have his BKB on, boom, that person's caught by the carapace. Also, Pugna will get stunned. Queen of Pain, we've already mentioned she's going to be AoEing. That's another target you can stun out. Fade Bolt, again AoE. There are many options for a carapace kind of game here for the Energy Pacemaker lineup, and we see an immediate TP from that Nyx Assassin onto that bottom lane. He wants to get some very aggressive ward up.
He needs that ward so he can grab some nice XP from that offlane. Actually, we had a Nyx Assassin today who did kind of horribly in his offlane, so this Nyx Assassin has to prove us that this is not the case. This is definitely in a blocking spot, as well as nicely seeing what's going on. If they actually... Yes, yes, they're gonna move there, so they definitely gonna see this. Everything should be fine, and XSS and heading back to the tower. No aggression on the other side really coming out, which means looks like a 50-50 bonus split, giving us the time to actually introduce Tim Fenn. Playing on the Phantom Lancer in the safe lane, we have Old Chicken, this time on the Leshrac. Lee on the Bounty Hunter, we have Dazzle, played by LT, and the one who planted that ward is, of course, Xiaolil on the Nyx Assassin.
And of course, on the flip side of that coin, for Tongfu on the Rubick, you've got LPC, and you've got Kabu playing the Pugna. That does leave ZinQ on the Gyrocopter, and of course, UUU9 handling the Queen of Pain. I think this is the first time I've seen him not playing Leshrac in about five games.
Yeah.
And then finally, up on that top lane, you do have Zex Bingo handling the Phoenix in that offlane role.
Yep, absolutely. So, you always want to bet. My finger is actually on Tongfu this time, just because I have like this horrible, horrible picture of a lot of explosions and whatnot in my head when it comes to a clutch fight of Tongfu, where I don't see EP actually surviving it. Even with Doppelganger dodges and nice initiations and shallow craves, I just don't see it happening. What can happen is one thing. The Bounty Hunter will be nice in roaming. They get track gold really fast up, benefit of that, and then we keep talking that maybe the Phantom Lancer reaches a level where EP can push relatively early, capitalize on the advantage. But that's pretty much my contingency on this vote.
I personally see a lot of squishy targets, and a lot of squishy targets with a Nyx Assassin and a Bounty Hunter. It's going to force quite a bit of sentries to be purchased as well as dust. So that's going to drain from the economy of Tongfu. On top of that, the damage of a Shuriken, 375 at max level. As well as, of course, the damage from a Nyx Assassin. Those two alone, before you consider any of the other cores, will be able to do quite a bit of work in this game. So I'm going to put my money on Energy Pacemaker for game number three.
Yeah. What I also don't like, by the way, is the simple fact that we have two invisible heroes on one team. So Tongfu wants to actually start it to like go for sentries, go for a gem, have dust on the initiation heroes, at least for those who can just carry it then later into the game. Then yeah, the Nyx Assassin is just equally screwed as the Bounty Hunter. That's what I kind of dislike. You want to have like that one invisibility hero that is forcing out, like spending that 200 gold on the sentry, spending the 180 on the dust, spending the gold on the gem and then losing it, which is a huge network drop, regardless of the stage of the game. Like, a gem is always something very precious.
That much I can agree on. I can understand your worries about two invis heroes, but I honestly think we can actually see quite a bit of work from the Nyx, even without Vendetta, if he goes for that Blink Dagger. And I expect a Blink Dagger. Speaking of Nyx, he could be in a bit of trouble. He's eating quite a few right clicks, and now you've got LPC coming in with that block. However, the Carapace will stun out the Pugna of Kabu, and of course the nice double hero Impale.
Look at this.
However, now you get
fire
the rotation spirits in from Zex, and these Fire Spirits are doing a lot of work. In comes a Shadow Strike as well, and that's First Blood coming the way of LPC on that Rubick. That's quite the amount of effort to get that First Blood, but it's more than worth it.
This is just a Lightning level one, level 2, so this is not going to do much. The Rubick might have been a potential turnaround target if the Bounty Hunter was there for Janara slow and then a right click of the Leshrac, but he was just not fast enough in that position. The play by Tongfu, definitely nice. The Phoenix rotating that early, I mean, who expects an offline Phoenix to be at the bottom rune? However, the Rubick, he bought completely everything out, suicides to the camp, and is fast back to the fountain. That's of course always a nice way to return to the fountain. It screws a bit with the scoreboard, but it doesn't really matter. We know and we will remember.
Indeed we shall. I gotta admit, I didn't expect to see a Phoenix rotate from the offlane there either. Was that a TP to the mid-tier one and then a rotation?
Oh, there is an interesting rotation here by the Bounty Hunter. Is there a courier? It's a flying courier already. We are beyond 3 minutes. So the Bounty Hunter actually stealing that one. Interesting. It's actually flying in. Let's see if the timing is right.
He does have Janata. He has Janata. This could work.
One right click. One.
Two. Yeah, he gets it. The extra damage coming through from the Shadow Walk by using it. That was perfect.
This
and
is
that
nine.
Is a bottle.
Yes. This is 900 gold. This is a bottle plus. I don't know what else was in. It's... yeah, very, very nice to get this done.
Bottle and boots.
Yeah.
That is huge. A bottle and boots locked away for 3 minutes. That's all belonging to Old Chicken as well, so this is going to be very detrimental.
Absolutely, absolutely. This is exactly the thing the Leshrac needs after... Oh, what?
I was targeting the wrong courier, sorry. Bottle and wand, I was going to say. Old chicken, no.
900
yeah.
gold.
Bottle and wand.
Oh, but look at the Queen of Pain dying now to the Bounty Hunter. He was still behind the tower, low due to the Leshrac, and then they just get that kill. However, we have the Nyx Assassin. He actually was invisible, and now he comes up with the stun, but there's another blast, clearing out the creep wave, and the next creeps are not even pulled by the Nyx Assassin, so they can go full YOLO on this tower. That's a lot of damage. That's why the cliff is coming out right now, right here, but he can't really do anything. That's the downside of a Nyx Assassin. Level 3, what is he supposed to do?
Not much at all, in all honesty. There's very little he can do at level 3. I got to admit, the Bounty Hunter being able to sneak around and snipe like that, it's working out very well. And if we see many more rotations like that after track, it's going to put quite a nail in the coffin of Anfu.
There is a little fight between Old Chicken and U9, but he didn't come out with a Split Earth. He was just fake casting, and the Queen of Pain tried to sidestep it. In the end, I think Old Chicken would have taken pretty much the larger damage just because of the Shadow Strike over time. We have a similar push going on top, but their pushing potential is way, way lower. The Bounty Hunter is actually, they're getting lifted up into the creeps. It won't be enough for a kill, absolutely enough. There is not a Phoenix to throw some Fire Spirits whatsoever. Actually, there is a Phoenix with Fire Spirits. He's coming in, Icarus Dive, the Fire Spirits landing on one. They need Shadow Crave on him for sure. Is that Shadow Crave? Yeah, right there. The Fate Ball not even connecting, so he's actually getting safe out there, but a nice rotation, nice play coming out by Phoenix and Rubick there.
Mm. Well, considering the investment of rotation, keeping that Bounty Hunter alive was well worth the effort, and it's just screwing around with Rubick again. They're making this Rubick rotate, and he's not getting any experience while doing so. He's only level 3.
Oh, and what's happening here? There's actually an attempted triple pull by the partner to like still do that. Like, Dongfu still in full laning phase if you... talk about creating space for the Gyrocopter. However, that all happens under Observer Ward, so the partner knew it every single point where they are. But look at this, the PL actually going for the Phoenix, and there the Icarus Dive is out, which means he has to hold back for a long time because Draco Boots, they have to proc and he has to get the HP back.
Mm. Now, looking at this game, Petla, we're getting near the 7-minute mark. We're starting to see levels come online as all mid. Queen of Pain almost regrets her aggression, but
that was a Janada. That was a Janada opening into a Shuriken toss, but the Leshrac did not get his lightning or the Split Earth in, so that's really bad. But, well, there's an opening on the Phoenix. There is, however, a Dust being used, and, well, the Phoenix, he's not dying. The Orb of Venom is not enough to actually do something. Is he actually getting this kill? No! Oh, just a second before you could punch him, he's going down. So Bounty Hunter, a bit too greedy, but I think it was the best thing to do. He was kind of inconclusive what he really wanted to do, because first he saw the Dust and the Queen of Pain, and he was like, okay, I run. Then he realized, okay, I cannot run, I die anyway. So he wanted to go for the Phoenix. If he would have just gone full suicidal, then go for the Phoenix, die with him. Maybe even get the XP bonus. However, look at this. Bounty Hunter running directly into everything. Even the second cooldown is going to do the trick. The Phoenix, the Rubick lifting him up in the air. And that's an easy one here. The Bounty Hunter, well, he was the silent witness of this. And has to witness that his teammate had no chance whatsoever to escape. There is also some action going on here top. He wants to go for the tower, but he has, again, the third freaking Fire Spirit on him. And look, the Leshrac coming in, trying to kill off that... that Gyrocopter, but in the end, he was going for the Bounty Hunter, trying to finish it, and the Rubick. It's nighttime, but he still has the range. No, now it turns daytime. That would have been perfect. If he kept running, I think that might have been something on the Rubick. Did not happen. He has a haste rune, however, but...
Denied. Oh, no, yes. He got it. He managed to pick it up in time. I thought the deny came over the cliff.
It looked like
in
it.
Time.
It really it looked like it.
It did.
Yeah.
What can I say? This game... If they can keep these assassins down, if Tongfu can manage to deal with the Nyx and the Bounty and don't let this go out of control in terms of track, they have a real shot of being able to bring down this game, at least in the mid-game area. If this goes late, I favor a Phantom Lancer against a Gyrocopter any day of the week.
Maybe. That's something where I have my doubts. Where I don't have my doubts is that the Bounty Hunter is now having track, and now starts the interesting phase for EP, because... the track gold is something insanely nice to have. if you actually get kills that are tracks. So I think the next 10 minutes, 10 to 15 minutes, they have to be spent by EP going aggressive, trying to find kills, and trying to have the track around for your own sakes of gold, and of course for the sake of the bounty hunter gold, because then the bounty hunter has the chance to go into fast Dagon, for example, and blow up people just randomly behind the lines, snipe here and there, things you want to have and see. And that's very, very nice. However, oh, Lashvark, there is the cooldown, and he's gonna get both blows. He's not even gonna witness the second one, because he was dead at that time. The Nyx Assassin couldn't really do anything. They all have to go back to track. Well, helps a tiny bit of, I don't know, getting some distance between you and the gyrocopter, but in the end, that was a very clean strike on the Lashvark. It's a high-value target for Tung Fu to get down.
Indeed it is, and you gotta consider with the fact that Tung Fu are managing to get these pickoffs, get this damage onto a tier 2 already, this gyrocopter is going to become very scary very quickly, and he is always backed up by Kabu. So even if they do try to bring him down, Kabu can always heal that that gyrocopter and keep the fights going longer.
Absolutely, and well, on the mid, the bounty hunter tries to, I don't know, get something done, get some nice tracks out, and they are finally out. Having these tracks constantly rolling is of course a nice upside for EP, because they always know what the hell is going on. There is a stun on the Phoenix, he has Icarus dive, but that's exactly what you can do against it. But look at this, Sonic Wave and the Shadow Strike is gonna finish him off. There's no way Fan is gonna find that deny. He was thinking about it. If the impact does not kill you, you can actually deny him on low HP. But no, that one did not really happen. They have, however, still the Rubik, but no 4 stuff, no Plink Dagger. They cannot catch up to the PL. But still, it's a 1-for-1 trade, and it was a good one because the Phoenix was way higher than the Nyx Assassin in farm and experience. So I think it was an okay trade, especially because the Phantom Lancer profited from it too, as well.
Yeah, that Phantom Lancer, by the way, he's getting very scary. He's been pretty much left alone to his own devices. He's got an Aquila, as well as a drum and brown boots. So this is going to be something to keep an eye on. If Fan is left uncontested, I feel very worried for Tung Fu.
What I also like is that the bounty hunter is going around and EP are thinking straightforward. They know exactly what are the gyrocopter's next steps. He wants to stack Ancients, but that is of course now prevented with that sentry ward they just planted there. Either they have spent 100 gold for another sentry ward right there, or they just don't go for the Ancients. The Phoenix now, well, farming in the jungle. Sure, that's also possible. He doesn't want to show. I guess he is kind of baffled by the fact that he just got soloed, or almost soloed by a Nyx Assassin, especially Spike Carapace, really owning you, because the Icarus Dive does immediately damage and stuns you in flight, which is of course bad. Otherwise, you always need like a Rubik or Earthshaker that can interrupt the Icarus Dive in flight in a bad position, and then the Phoenix just has like, kaka, kaka, and goes down.
In the meantime, speaking of a Rubik, there is a smoke going on, and it seems like the target is going to attempt to be Fan, but that is not the easiest of kills. Even with a smoke, even with a Queen of Pain and a Rubik, that's not easy. Instead, they'll go on to LT, who they find checking a rune, and well, I wouldn't want to be a dazzle right about now. There's no way he's surviving this one, I don't think. Nope. Tries to heal himself up, but one stream comes through from UUU9, and that's another kill in the pocket of Tung Fu.
He does the only thing he can actually do. I mean, I don't even know why he didn't have a TP scroll with him. Maybe he carried something else there. No, actually he didn't, but there's a go on the Leshrac. There's no telekinesis left, no mana pretty much on the Rubik. But yeah, you cannot even reinitiate or something like that. Oh, the Bounty Hunter. They thought he's gonna go up this way, so the cooldown was a good guess, but Bounty Hunter, there's no track, no dust, nothing actually hit him. So Gyrocopter, there goes pretty much your cooldown. It's a low cooldown anyway. So, who cares? He's trying to stack, and the second he's gonna stack it, he will notice, okay, it's blocked.
I gotta consider one thing, though. Have we actually seen a track kill yet since the Bounty Hunter got 6?
Hmm? Sorry?
Have we seen a track kill yet since the Bounty Hunter got level 6?
No. The track was really just for vision at this point. So far, not a single track kill, no.
That is something that does worry me. Since the early game, you have that burst damage capability from the Shuriken Toss, and they're not managing to find the kills, especially combined with, say, a Leshrac or the Nyx. And they can play 4, protect 1, and just go aggressive while the PL farms for the most part.
Instead,
they're losing towers.
Yeah. What's interesting is also the fact that we have kind of a role swap at the moment. The Bounty Hunter is going for Headdress. I don't know if that's in the Flooded Mirrors, which is good for him because he can actually farm and everything. Right now he has to be careful, like, yeah, just going invisible and TPing at the same time, which you can do. But If that's, I don't know if that, I doubt it's gonna be a mech on the Bounty Hunter. This is going into Vladimir's, I bet on it. But would have been funny that we have the medallion, which we sometimes see by the Bounty Hunter, is on the Dazzle. And then the other way around on the Bounty Hunter, we have the mech. But it's, I don't think it's gonna happen. I don't think anyone is gonna pick up a mech this game.
I'm not too sure about that. You could see a mech picked up.
No, I mean, EP. Like, Kabul will definitely go for it.
Yeah. If NG Pacemaker don't go for a mech, they at least need that Vladimir's, and I am inclined to agree with you. That's going to be most likely a Vladimir's on Lee. Vladimir's on Bounty Hunter can do so much work.
Yep. And what I also like is at the moment that they start to put up sentry wards in key positions, like here in the mid lane, we already had one top, so the Bounty Hunter going through there is pretty hard. Well, however, well, we have an Icarus dive. Was that him actually going to the next camp, or guessing that they come? No, but there is a sentry ward, and well, they can go into the supernova, but no, that's not gonna happen. The mana burn is finishing it off. Some nice mana on the way, but, oh, Queen of Vayne coming in. There's the cooldown. Is there any vision? The first one hits. Do they go for the courier? I would love so loud at the moment. There's a sentry ward. They're hiding. Bounty Hunter is hiding. Both of them are actually hiding. I think you're hiding really well. The Bounty Hunter gives the TP to the Nyx, and he's TPing out. The Bounty Hunter, I guess he's just gonna stay here or run to the tier 2 tower. Either or, I think he's safe.
Well, that was quite the escape there by Lee on that Bounty Hunter, and it seems I'm very wrong. It is, in fact, a mechanism on Lee. Kefka, you were right. God damn it.
Well, it was an interesting thought because, it's not too bad for a Bounty Hunter, especially against the Gyrocopter. Like, some physical damage is coming through there, getting the stats, getting the armor, getting the heal on yourself, plus your team if you're positioned well. I'm just worried about the position, but still, I just accept the fact that they go for the mech. It's going to be a reasonable time for the fact that this is a roaming Bounty Hunter that had barely any laning. But let's see, 60 minutes into it, nobody's gonna craft the runes. We have the Phantom Lancer actually working on a tier 2 tower, while they work on the other tier 2 tower in the mid. Of course, who's actually gonna win this race? It's a 4-on-1 situation. The Netherblast should be way, way faster, but they also struggle with the creep wave taken out too fast, and that tower, well, the tower also struggles, sort of, but the Phantom Lancer, it's getting too hot for him here.
Well, for the Phantom Lancer, honestly, if he just keeps the split farming up, he's going to be completely fine. He's got the travels, he's got a drum. Item-wise next, I'm thinking Diff Blade maybe, just so he can be on top of anyone he sees fit and just burn them of all their mana. You know, he doesn't like anyone with mana, but speaking of mana, in comes UUU9 with a full complement, so that's at least going to have some awareness of that due to the track, but it's just going to be a case of split farming fan. That's all that's going to happen for the foreseeable future. Unless we see a massive amount of track kills. And it seems we have more stats. Mech first, 81% win rate. Seems us lowly casters know nothing, which is to be expected. Vlad's 57%.
Yeah, well, let's see where this one is going with the Bounty Hunter. At the moment, I'm still waiting for track kills. But no, I'm not so sure this is actually happening, because every time the Bounty Hunter is somewhere, there's not really a follow-up. They're just always on the other side of the map. I mean, it's nice that he keeps track of what's going on. He's testing where our sentry wards. Like, for example, now, I think they saw this one. There was a plink, or there was the Leshrac actually pinging. But if he goes north, then there's still a residual sentry ward. Now, Leshrac is coming in, but invisible Rubik stole that, and are easy going on that Leshrac. Don't even need Sonic Wave or anything. This is just going for it straight in the face. Leshrac. It's not working out.
No, it's not. And considering Pulse Nova was stolen by the Rubik as well, if Rubik has a full mana complement, he can actually do a considerable amount of damage. But bot lane, we do have a little bit of a skirmish going on. You got the Phantom Lancer trying to push this tower in. Did force a good few rotations from Kabu as well as Zex Bingo. And, well, if they just force rotations like this, Phantom Lancer is just going to teleport to another lane. He's farming top now. And, of course, Bounty Hunter does see himself LPC. LPC, he needs to be careful, but so does Zinku. Rubik steals track, actually. Stolen track, that's going to be pretty damn huge. And with that kind of damage...
Thanks for the gold.
Yeah, thanks for the gold. I have a feeling Tongfu are going to use track better than Energy Pacemaker now that this has happened.
At this point, yes, because they win the fight top. In the mid, nothing is really going on, but also EP is not really using that space. And in the meantime, there's, well, the tower damage rolling out by Kabu, and Kabu, yeah, PvE player through and through. He really wants to get those towers. Nice some split push, getting, I think he got one or two blasts into the tower. Now they have to go back, which is the right thing to do. But yeah, that's the biggest problem. We are nearing the 20-minute mark. There's not much done with the track. Not a single track kill, if I'm not mistaken. If I missed one, then excuse me. But
there was a track on the Phoenix. That was the first kill. That was about 12 minutes into the game. Then the next track kill was the Bounty getting killed by the stolen track.
Yeah, I don't count the stolen track.
I count it. Of course I count it.
Well,
it's a track kill, damn it.
Maybe we're gonna see something now, but the problem is directly into a sentry ward and the track on the other side, and well, there's already the slow. It should still be fine because of Carapace. That's the mini stun, but well, there's also the track here on the Bounty Hunter. They find him, the first tick is coming through, he's turning around, but well, he should be safe with that Shadow Grave and also the lightning. Everything should slow them down, but they still have enough steam to keep on going on this tier 2 tower here. From the back lines, well, we have the Phantom Lancer coming in, but just no way he actually catches out that Queen of Pain.
Everyone is near enough tracked right now, damn it. Tracks for everyone on both sides. I'm surprised we didn't get a fight kick off then. That would have been a massive cold graph jump.
Well, I actually thought they have enough steam to keep on going for a fight, but right now, well, the sentry wards, the block actually went off the ancients. So we have a triple or quadruple stack. I don't know. I can't trust my eyes. It's at least a triple stack. Nope, it's a quadruple stack. It's four big ancients. So yeah, quadruple stack for the gyrocopter. He's going to be happy with this one. That's tons of gold for him.
That's BKB done.
Yep. And with that BKB, is he actually stoppable at this point? The Leshrac is not going to do much against him except for Diabolic Edict. The track after the BKB, yes. The Defender Lancer, well, for him, there's just a Diffusal play done. And he tried to get a tier 1 tower, but there's a rotation by the Queen of Pain, Double Ganger, and now turning it around, boosting all that mana stolen, the stick being used, and now he has to run. He should be fine, not, of course, if the Queen of Pain finds this. And just before he dies, there's the track up. I think they should trade the heroes because the Rubik is really doing a goddamn good job. He has the spell for not much longer. That's the biggest problem. He needs to really steal it again.
Yeah, he'll lose it in about 10 seconds time. Hell, even less, 5 seconds time. But now, well, we do have a Bounty Hunter and a Nyx around, and they're just going to murder the Pugna. And we get a stolen Shuriken toss, which is going to be a quite large amount of burst damage. Carapace comes out, going to slow down this fight. And it seems we're going to walk away with the assassin. So it's a one for one. The PL goes down in exchange for the Pugna. And I don't think that's quite the worthwhile trade for Energy Pacemaker.
No, I think Kabu should not have been in the front lines there. But I think they were quite confident that they're like all going back and retreating and whatnot. And he was totally surprised by the fact that, well, that this one is coming. He actually stole, yeah, Shuriken toss. He even utilizes it right now just to farm a tiny bit. A Rubik suddenly with the Shuriken toss is also something very interesting. He comes at you, gets a right click in Fate Bowl, that's about 300 damage, then the Shuriken toss. It's quite dangerous, you should not underestimate how much burst it can be. It's still not as good as track, of course, because from the track, his entire team benefits, which is quite amazing. Talking about benefiting and getting gold, Kung Fu actually took over the network lead after EP was very, yeah, decent in it, but oh, that's a plummeting a tiny bit with the Pugna kill. It's still a fairly even game if you really think about it. 500 gold in 22 minutes, couldn't be more even. Queen of Pain, however, talking about net worth, just denied some gold for EP.
More tower denies. We've seen many in this tournament, actually, quite a damn few. But just going to move back to this Rubik for a second, that's 655 damage for 300 mana. That's slightly more and slightly more expensive mana cost than a level 1 Finger of Death for this Rubik at this point.
Yep. And Bounty Hunter at the tower trying to find something, but you will not find anyone there. Simply because the entire Tong Fu team is heading towards the mid. The Queen of Pain already behind the tower. Actually, they see her right there. And well, there's the Shadow Cry getting out. Is there any interrupt? Nope, there's nothing they can do at this point. So he's safe. They try to do some split pushing at the same time, but hell, like a PL alone can't really do anything. A ton of illusion, sure, but the cliff is being used. And they say, hey, guys, we are way, way faster. Let's go for tier 3. Also painting the cliff out here. Now the question is there any rotation? The Bounty Hunter is going back. They need him. They need the track on all those heroes. If they dive, if they get killed, then that's, of course, very much worth it. There is a Decrepify. on another wall. They try to prevent this from actually getting killed. There is, however, there's the engagement on the Lashrak. The egg is already down. He's getting slowed by his own stolen spell right now. There is the Nyx Assassin. He's definitely going down because there's nothing left. Try to save himself into the Vendetta. Not gonna work. So Phoenix being very, very low. The Phantom Lancer actually going for it. That's one kill. Well, the Doppelganger. Is there something else? 10-second BKB coming out by the Gyrocopter. And now the question is, can they go for more? Blink Dagger on the Ruig, but he's already going to die. Do we have another track? Anything? Yes. Well, this one is also going down. Was the Gyrocopter a track kill?
Yes, that was two tracks and a non-track kill.
Nice. So that's pretty much EP's gold right there. Tons of gold for them. And with this respawn timer, going for Roshan might be the right thing to do, yes?
When you're ahead, get more ahead. Roshan, one of the best ways to do that. And considering those two track kills, you can basically say it's loads of money for an pacemaker right now. And it's going to be interesting to see how this actually impacts the gold graph when this Roshan falls.
Yep, I mean, the gold graph is already plummeting. This is thanks to track and everything, not to mention that Tongfu was tiny bit ahead, of course. There's a 3k plummet right there. Roshan is going to net. Add another K on top of that, easily, maybe even more. And
that is an avalanche.
If you think about it, like the tier 3 tower, that wasn't really worth it. Like they got 50% on the tier 3 tower and had to pay so much for it. So EP, they're happy with this one. Maybe even going for more. There is a smoke in the mid, but well, that's not gonna do anything. Unfortunately, there's no tier 1 tower to go into because I think EP had the feeling that, well, maybe they could go for more. Right now, they just fall back and keep on farming hard. Is the next step for the Phantom Lancer. That adds a lot of tankiness for him. And you already seen that he has quite a lot of stats. I mean, he carries at the moment Aquila, Drums, and the Reaver. Standing there with 1.7k. That's definitely nice. Getting a lot of defusal damage into targets where he can lock on. Unless, of course, it's the BKB target, the Gyrocopter. Then he just has to wait down to 9. 8 seconds. Oh, he used it before. I thought it was the first time, but never mind.
And on the meantime, we do have a 5-man rotation heading towards that top lane by Tongfu. Are we going to be looking for a tier 2 push, really?
Well, it looks like it. I mean, the Nyx Assassin was there just for a second. He TP'd out, but there's nothing else to get. Do we have a smoke by them? It's like a 3-man group looking for something. Nope, not really. There's a double damage that might actually be interesting for the Phantom Lancer. But yeah, he's going for a bottom push just on his own. He of course has the confidence of the Aegis right now on his side. It's something where he doesn't have to be too scared. Then again, if he gets caught out alone, then Aegis also doesn't help him much. Like, of course, with double walk, you survive a bit longer and everything, but yeah, I wouldn't trust in that Aegis too much. Smoke, they actually smoked up top, but going for the tower reveals them, and I think EP knows that where the Gyrocopter is, there has to be a tiny bit more. Three of them show up. The Phoenix is in the backlines. Rubik, I think he wants to grab a TP just because they know, apparently, they're gonna keep on pushing here. T3 is in process.
In the meantime, though, let's see what Energy Pacemaker can do. They did commit the Phantom Lancer to the front lines there, forcing the cooldown. Cooldown doesn't really do anything other than scaring back the PL for now. Oh, and we do get track. Another stolen track. Here we go again, LPC. Let's see what he can do.
Well, this is really bad. Like, first mission right now, kill the Rubik. Kill him before he can actually use that track, just as he did the first time he stole it. So, let's see where this one is going. I hope the Bounty Hunter... I mean, the reaction of the Rubik was really nice. The second he casted the track, he also stole it. And there was no sentry, no nothing. And he immediately used Shadow Walk, but in the Fate Time, he had, like, that fast reaction, so... Yeah, kudos to him. They still kind of continue on this one, and now he eats his own track right there, so there's no way for him to actually go back. The question is now, EP, do they want to push? Do they want to, like, really force this fight simply because, well, there is... What's happening here? Queen of Pain going in, now using the BKB. That was very, very questionable play right now. Illusion's not going to finish him off. He survives with 15 HP, and now, well, there is the BKB by the Gyrocopter going full ham, as well as the Egg, the Phantom Lancer. He's going to pop the Aegis right here, but it's not even going to get caught in this illusion, so it's a 1-0 nothing trade if you count the Aegis in, but I think they can continue. There is, well, a stun attempt by the Nyxus and not going to work. The counter track, the Rubik is not going to steal anything else. He's so happy with that track, and they're going to keep continuing here. There is exactly that. Sentry Ward coming out, Nether Ward on the high ground. They have to kill this one, and the illusions flying in, the Lashrak spamming as well. What's actually going to happen here? Well, Nyx Assessing I thought they're gonna toss him on a tower and there is some follow-up, but it's not really happening. I don't know, everybody is pretty much tracked here on...
on both sides.
Yeah, on both sides.
Rubik, however, did just lose the track. He stole Impale from Nyx Assassin, so they're looking to set up for a team fight. All the members of Energy Pacemaker have just fallen back. And the Phantom Answer is already up on that top lane, farming that up and pushing it down. Expect to see the heart on him in the foreseeable future.
Yep, 30 minutes into the game. The shift of gold is real, but then again, it's also stack mining. So after that 4k advantage EP had, they didn't really get much after Roshan. They lost their Aegis. I got some cooldown off Tong Fu, even though that initiation was kind of scary. They tried to find the bounty hunter right now, at least it feels like it, but there's no sentry, there's a dust on cooldown on the Rubik. And is there anything else? I don't think so, but there's a track on a gyrocopter. Is that something they want to engage on? Lushrak in the mid? No, that's just too far spread out right now.
And the assassins are certainly lurking there as a pair. However, if any of them get caught under a ward, they're both pretty much dead, which is the... bit of a downside. I do, however, very much like 2's build on this Nyx. He's got a blink dagger, best item on Nyx ever.
Yeah,
and he's going for an Aghanim's.
Yeah, the Aghanim's is also a very interesting item. But funny enough, after the patch, that I didn't cast a single Nyx assassin in so many games, and yesterday I saw the first time the Aghanim's scepter in action, besides a freaking pub where people don't use it correctly anyway. So yeah, it can actually be in some situations so powerful. But talking about powerful, I also think that push he might go for here in the mid is also powerful, because they still have the tier 2 tower to go, which clears them the way to maybe even go for a dual Rex after the buyback situation cleared, or they get like a pretty heavy fight. But it seems like they, I don't know, for now they just killed Gyrocopter's creep. No more stacking for you.
Oh, they need to do something to stop this Gyrocopter, because he's been farming stack after stack uncontested, and he's not exactly light on the farm. He's 14.2k net worth, BKB, Dominator, Sanji Asher. I'm expecting a Satanic, for Christ's sake.
Yeah, I mean, the Satanic is, I wouldn't say a game changer, but we saw in the previous games how tanky a Gyrocopter can be that actually is in the fight and stays in the fight and has the chance to actually get a second life with the Satanic if he has something to hit. May it be a creep wave, may it be any other hero stunned next to him. That is pretty much really full HP, and not to mention the damage. He just has to outlast, for example, for a second go of Flak Cannon, which then of course translates in a sick amount of AoE damage. Roshan still far away. Let's just check if, I don't know, someone left something here. Yes, destroyed. 225 gold down. Net worth loss. Insane.
Well, I have to wonder, what is the next objective for both of these teams? Is it a case of, do we farm up and wait for Roshan? Or is it, do we invest everything and try to kill Fan? Which is, I think, what Tong Fu are going to try. They go on him, they commit the Sonic Wave and the Screams. Can they burn him down in time, though? There's the Doppelwarp. Can he escape? Supernova as well, that's going to clear a lot of the trees. And Tong Fu, UUU9, gets the Mega Kill, bringing down that pesky Cancer Lancer.
Yep. Actually, that was also a very much needed kill. He is worth 1,000 gold right there, almost 2k experience. That was very, very much needed for Tong Fu to get him. And, well, based on that, is there actually more happening? There is a cooldown on the Dazzle, but he's using the he's using the play just to trick him. There has to be a Shallow Grave, otherwise he's gonna get all the damage. Does he actually TP out? He could TP out, but he's not really using it at the moment. Nope, he's just using the Shadow Amulet. And of course the Gyrocopter, being scared that he is a bit too far out, he's going back. The Nyx Assassin, that's also very interesting. He's fighting at the moment a Centaur, a dominated Centaur, who's getting stunned. And therefore the tower push is not as successful as he might have thought. We have, however, look at the Bounty Hunter coming in. They might actually be able to blow something up, that TPC here, just for defense purposes. Then again, talking about defense, the tier 2 tower here, where the cliff is just being used, well, this one is also definitely going down. Looks like a tier 2 trade if Nyx is assassin successful, but it is enough. The Sonic Wave finishes off that Bounty Hunter. He could have probably used the Mac and would have survived, but then who gets you afterwards?
More importantly, the gyro did deny the tower as well from that one. So it's a tier 2 in favor of Tong Fu, and a tower denied in favor of Tong Fu as well.
Yep, the gold wise, net worth wise, definitely a strike to EP, not to mention losing the Bounty Hunter, who misses valuable time like tracking people, which is always nice because it's a running ward for EP whenever he gets a track up. Well, at least the Phantom Lancer is back. What is his next item? Does he go for evasion on this one just to have like a man fight again against the Phantom Lancer? Or what do we see on him?
Evasion, maybe, but I think in this case an MKB is the order of business. I don't think he's going for it. I think he's just going for the MKB just to try to mini-stun as much as humanly possible, considering you have Fan, who's already got the heart from here on. He goes for evasion. He goes for a butterfly.
Yep, absolutely. And, well, what is he doing now? He's hiding on the side because nobody of EP has any idea where they are. We have an invisible Queen of Pain, four of them somewhere around the mid. Is there smoke incoming? Yeah, the Rubik has one. So I think Tong Fu, they want to find more. It's actually a good timing because if you fight right now, there's Roshan waiting for you. Maybe it's even a smoke into Roshan. Let's see. But then again, I don't know. Someone just declared this a parking spot. The Aghanim Scepter Nyx is hiding, burrowing here. I'm not so sure. He should have burrowed, I don't know, in the Rosh pit.
Well, if the Nyx manages to make use of the Aghanims in the Rosh pit, that could be quite painful.
That's an awkward position.
Oh, this is bad. If he gets caught by the stun, that's one stun. And the mana brain break all of these stuns in the world. There's no way Zinkyu's surviving this one. BKB's popped as well. This is exactly what they needed. Now they're trying to bring down the supernova. Can they manage it? No, they can't. The supernova will complete. Bingo gets that off in time, but he's going to have to Rikos dive out, surely. They can't fight in the middle of this. The only one going down so far is the Bounty Hunter on EP's lineup, whereas they've lost a Gyrocopter and the Phoenix on
they
Kung
might
Fu.
Get the Rubik.
Kung Fu forced to retreat.
They might get the Rubik. The Blink Dagger is still on cooldown. The Force Staff as well. There's the Lance. There's even the Diffusal Plate. And whoo, he just exploded right there. So it's a 3-for-1 trade. That parking yourself somewhere in the trees worked out perfectly here for EP. It was, in Counter-Strike we call that camping. Well, here in Dota, it's just a smart play, I guess.
I'll let it go. I'm not going to comment this time. Seems in the meantime we get that tier 3 tower pushing. If we can get this tower scrapped and brought down, that's going to be very, very favourable towards NG Pacemaker if they can finally break the base. It seems certainly they can. Then again, Gyrocopter is up in 10 seconds and this tower isn't falling, considering it's still got its backdoor regen online.
Yep, they really try to, but then again, the Phantom Lancer, he will heal up unless, of course, he has a Shadow Strike on him. Now they use the clip. Everybody's back, and now, there we go, Queen of Pain popping the BKB. They wait it out. They want to see something else, but the Dazzle, oh, that's of course bad. He's not going to contribute to this fight. The cooldown just zoning them out at the moment. The Illusions in the background actually quite in trouble, that Rubik, and they're going to get another kill on the Nyx Assassin, and maybe even more here. BKB soon going to end, but there is, well, everything popped by the Leshrac. Now he's trying to turn this around, even the invisibility, and I think this is a bit too far out. Mr. Gyrocopter, there he goes down. Also, another track, possibly on the Rubik. That's the second track kill right now. The turn around is real, and do they get the kill on Kabu? Yes, it's absolutely enough. Is there interrupt? Yes, there is the Shuriken Toss. They lose 4. How many buybacks did they spend before? That was 0. They really just waited for the timer. I thought one of them actually brought it back. With this, however, they have to go for the buyback. They have to go for the buyback to hold this. They need the next creep wave, however. Or in the mid, well, mid actually might lose the tier 2 tower just on their own. And they have to go for it. There's Sonic Wave, but the Leshrac barely getting any damage there. With the Diffuser Plate and barely any mana. And the stun on the Queen of Pain, they might actually get this kill, but no, it's not gonna happen. The egg, well, that's definitely gonna lead to a stun. He has no. There's no doppelganger for now, and the Gyrocopter also low in damage at the moment. The next lance actually might bring him in trouble. There's the doppelganger, there is the Janata, and just blowing him up. Also, the Phoenix, super low HP, but it's not going to be enough for a kill. Nothing is really there. And, well, Queen of Pain trying to get the Leshrac. That's a kill. That's a killing spree for the Queen of Pain as well. The facet is pretty much... No, it's not even over. She just playing forward and now she's in trouble from the PL, by the PL. The Rubik, however, he doesn't have 4 stuff, he doesn't have Blink Dagger. That's pretty much a safe kill, unless something bad is gonna happen to that PL. That dive might be a bit too deep. The partner is coming, could have helped with a Decrepify. And what do we have? We have actually the Leshrac coming in with BOTs. They're still not done with this. 40 seconds on the Gyrocopter.
They won't be done with this until that tower is, and the racks are dead on this lane. The Gyrocopter has a dieback, so he's going to be out of this for another 30 seconds, guaranteed.
Now, look at this. There is the pushing machine.
Edig. Nyx is going to set up here with a Borrow. There's no detection either, so this could be a huge thing, especially considering Kabu is going to be the primary target. Scream comes out from the Queen of Pain. That does a huge amount of damage, and Fan, he almost goes down. He's still standing for now. and double walker last second. In the meantime, though, you do have two doing so, so much work in that burrow.
Well, sure, he did a good job, but they lost the Phantom Lancer. Whoa, he's actually coming back.
I should think so. He's got the boots of travel. He can come back for round two all he likes. It's all five for Energy Pacemaker still alive. Sure, they might lose the Nyx Assassin. He gets into that Burrow with that Shallow Grave. He's going to be able to survive this one for a little bit longer with the damage reduction the Burrow gives you. All it'll take is a good stun and to catch Zinq as well, which he can do when he's in that Carapace form.
Oh, he has no charges on that Diffuser Blade, but he doesn't even need it. There's a gem on the crown as well. Nyx Assassin says thank you, a mech from the Bounty Hunter on everybody, and they're just going to rotate into, well, the open tier 3, the one that's actually accessible in the mid, the tier 2 tower. That's just too much HP, can't really go for it, so yes, they can capitalize on this easily. Cooldown, everything still on cooldown, and the Rubick actually going in. Everybody's being stunned, but yeah, he's gonna die. Sonic Wave, nice angle, plus the Shivas, that's gonna take out 2, and maybe even 3. Yes, there's still, well, still the PL fighting. He's trying to TP out, he's actually successfully with it, and, well, that's just a tier 3, and a very surprising little turnaround. I thought EP is really gonna go through with this.
It's quite a shaking thing when you're so confident that you buy back your PL, you go straight for that tier 3 and rack from the bottom lane, you manage to do it, and then you rotate for the open one and get repelled.
Look at the graph.
That was huge. The graph is telling. It's a 12,000 gold lead for EP.
It's a 10k sweep, pretty much.
It's a 5,000 experience lead for EP, but that swing, Jesus Christ, that swing is insane.
Yeah, I mean, this is multiple buybacks, losing net worth on one side, gaining net worth, plus tracks and whatnot on the other side. I mean, there was also a buyback, of course, on the PL, so that's one thing, but still, Tong Fu lost so, so much here right now, and On the Dead Courier, that was the upgrade for the Diffusal Plate. Like, I was wondering, because he would have gotten the Gyrocopter a second time if he had a Diffusal Charge. He just needed to slow him. The Diffusal Plate level 2 was in the Courier. So that's actually too bad. Sometimes Couriers really screw you over. There is a Roshan, of course, open to get, but Tong Fu, they know. They get Roshan, we just have another push on our hands, which we cannot just buy back into, so they have to hide. And there's a little mushroom here on the high crown. That looked funny.
Well, as it stands, in this game, this could still go either way. That's the thing. That's the thing that gets me the most. Sure, you've got Fan, who's massive on this Phantom Lancer. He's still completely killable by the Gyrocopter.
Yep.
Gyrocopter's now got the MKV. Finally, he might have enough damage to be able to reliably kill everyone else, not just the PL.
Yeah, I definitely like how the Queen of Pain approached the last fight. That was quite amazing. He had an angle of the Sonic Wave into four heroes, and the Shivas, like, I think, peeled on 2. That was very amazing. I think the most damage, the instant damage right there was insane. That's what EP did not expect. Mech on cooldown. However, they... Oh, is that for reals? They smoke into Roshan, but I think the risk of starting Roshan and then getting caught out, that might be too high. Gyrocopter is looking at it. What about it, Roshan? You and me, right here? Yes, they're gonna go for it.
This is so risky. This is so risky.
Yeah. Look at it, they're coming.
One of these revealed.
Oh, they're coming. Phantom Lancer, finding a lens somewhere. Is there a telekinesis? Actually, oh, they're not gonna lift him up at the partner. Already getting so much damage. There is pretty much nothing happening on that PL. He's just gonna use double walk out. There is even a Shallow Grave. They try to really help him, but now Phantom Lancer, he could pretty much turn this around if he has another. No, he has not. He's out for 100 seconds, but still, Leshrac going ham on that Gyrocopter. But look at the yellow beam. They're healing him up with everything they can, but there's the stun, there's the mana burn, and that's not really gonna help. So free down and all that just for the price of that one Phantom Lancer. So yeah, Phantom Lancer, the official bait. The only problem is the Queen of Pain is still alive. She could still ruin your day if you go into Roshan, so I don't think they're gonna do it. Still, if they had the Phantom Lancer right now, we could look at a potential finish by EP. Without the Phantom Lancer, I think Tong Fu just bought some time.
A little bit of time, yes. They invested so, so much to kill the PL. What they didn't realize, the biggest threat for them right now is that bloody Leshrac. He is doing so much damage with the Pulse Nova, and he doesn't have an Aghanim's yet, which does improve the damage, considerably so.
Absolutely, and I think they decided to still push, not for the base, but maybe for a tier 2. Why not just get into tier 2 right now, They're still on a decent-ish respawn time at 10 seconds. They don't need more. And they would not use the cliff on a tier 2. I doubt that. They decide to go into Roshan. Do we have BOTs 1 or 2 on the Pendulum? So I think, yeah, level 1. So he couldn't even just TP into Roshan and grab the Aegis. The Aegis will go to Old Chicken. Yes, he really wants it. He has even a slot free for the cheese. Well, that could actually be something for the Phantom Lancer. If he had a slot, he could drop the stick. Of course, you prefer a cheese over 70 stick charges, I guess.
Incoming. Queen of Pain. U9, he's lurking. He does have backup as well. In comes LPC. There's the jump in with that Shiva's Guard. The combo is there with the screen, doing good damage. But can they still finish the Roshan is my question. Who's going to get it? In the meantime, you've got Nyx in the backbone. BKB in that burrow, trying to do everything he can. In comes the Supernova. They need to bring this down. UU9 jumps in. Leshrac got the Aegis. Queen of Pain, however, kills off the Bounty Hunter with that damage. That damage from the Queen is still very, very noticeable. And now you've got the Leshrac on the high ground, needing to TP out. Taking so much damage from that Nether Ward. 2 going to go down in the long run, but now you've got the PL. Fan is back in, and he's going to die at this rate. He's just getting drained completely. That's a 4-man wipe. Leshrac only barely able to get out of that one. What a swing. What catastrophic swing.
Yes, absolutely catastrophic. Like, wait, I'm so confused. Who got what? Who got the Aegis? Was that the Leshrac and he died on it? Yes.
I could swear I saw the Aegis picked up by Energy Pacemaker at least.
Okay, let's find the Aegis. It's not there, so it has to be the Leshrac dying. Yes. And then
Leshrac did. He died.
But
then
it was still strange because the, like, after everybody dropped the Phantom Lancer, I mean, he was TPing here on the sidelines on a Creeper Wave, tried to get back into this fight, but by the time he reached that fight, pretty much everything was over, and then he was just like, hi guys, sorry to disturb, and then he just got blown to pieces. That was very strange in communication. That Roshan, and forcing this Roshan like this was totally not worth it for EP. They gave away a lot right here. Well, according to the graph, not too much, but still, it's just no Aegis for the next push. Well, let's see what's gonna happen here. The Bounty Hunter might actually scout them out top. The Pugna's already going back. The Phoenix, well, he should be mobile enough, and he has a gem, so he knows when, for example, the Bounty Hunter approaches. Still, 46 minutes in, you said it just before the fight, and whoa, someone is drawing a lot. I think the gyrocopter is mad.
You think? This game is going 46 minutes. It's a complete slobber knocker either way, and either side can still win, even though I look at the net worth graph and I see a 13k lead for Energy Pacemaker, and Energy Pacemaker could still lose this in a second.
Yeah, especially if you're really tight around the buybacks. I mean, the buyback on the PL is back, so that's one of your most important. Leshrac and PL having the buyback, very, very important. The Leshrac right now, he needs gold. He needs gold for the buyback, but it seems like he's interested in that Octarine Core because the second Zol booster is up, so we have to wait till this one is coming out. Of course, if he has that Octarine Core, then killing him in like these crazy clash fights where he does so much damage, then that's of course quite insane because he heals so much on this Octarine Core. But, well, let's see. It could be a gamble, like getting the Octarine Core but dying, or not getting it, trying to farm towards it, buying the components and then not having the buyback that you desperately need to stop Tong Fu after a bad fight pushing into your base. That's the gamble they have right now. Or maybe he even manages to get so much gold that he finishes it on the 2.7 Mystic Staff and then goes for more gold, but I doubt that. I actually think he's going for the Octarine Core right there because they're getting ready to push top. There are some naked Rexes standing, so why not just go in for them?
Well, if they go in for the Octarine Core and they push this down, it seems we may have a bit of a equally heavy push coming on the Dire bottom lane, actually, considering
Gyrocopter. Gyrocopter gotta be careful there. TPing alone in that situation, having no idea where the rest of that team is, he gets a track immediately up, and that's him going back to the fountain, pretty much.
Aye, and our good stats man Corrupt does say, Queen of Pain, Scythe of Ice, Void Stone, and Stash, this is going to be good for the Tong Fu lineup to try to seal this one. If they get a good Hex, and by a good Hex, I mean they Hex the Leshrac before he becomes a problem, or Hex the Dazzle and then kill the Lesh fast,
like
one or the other.
Pre-ultimate, pre-BKB, then the Hex is actually full value. Everybody goes back, Kung-Fu knows they cannot lose much more. The tower, however, got some damage, and I think they're just gonna drop this tower. There's no point in using the cliff on this one. It's not gonna reset anyway. It's a tier 2 tower, and they're gonna prepare themselves for a push into tier 3. The good thing is the Lash Shark right now pushing also the bottom lane, which is an easy thing for him to do. He has like, well, 55.3 MPS right here, and he can easily push that lane out. Even grabs the small camp just to be efficient. Oh, look at this! They saw the Bounty Hunter, and that's an easy target to go for. Well, Shadowcrave buying some time. Can he actually heal himself with the 17 stick charges? He's trying to get, well, something going with the Shuriken toss, but that's pretty much about it. The entire team of EP called back, and they just, yeah, just did that.
Yeah. This is the thing, they have so much vision on the side of Tongfu. I believe that was a gem, correct me if I'm wrong, saw that? It's a gem on the Phoenix. Yep. So it was just good dive there, catching the Bounty Hunter out of position. And it actually isn't a side device, it appears to be a full refresher orb coming onto UUU9. He's, 600 away from that refresher, and then we're going to have double sonic waves to contend with. That is a lot of pure damage.
Yeah, and the Octarine Core is now done on the Lashrak, plus 2k gold already. He still needs a tiny bit more to actually do something, but oh, Rubik with the gem finds the Dazzle, who's also invisible, but there is the very, very long impale by the Nyx Assassin out of the Boar stands, and, well, that's not gonna do anything. Like, that Dazzle, like, really lucky with everything. Also, the Rubik now, having a gem and having the Shadow Walk is quite interesting, because he might find the Bounty Hunter again.
Indeed, if they catch that Bounty Hunter again, that could actually be an opening for Tongfu to start getting some pressure on the racks. Maybe try to equalize their racks deficit.
By the way, look at the experience right now. I mean, not the graph, I'm looking at the levels. Like, that wasn't even a level 3 track all the time. I'm really surprised. We have 50 minutes in, and yes, the Bounty Hunter is playing a role. Oh, he got scouted by the Rubik. Is there a telekinesis or not? No, I don't think so. They suspect the team behind it, but still, he's not even level 16. He's really just dying that fast in fights and not getting enough lane presence or farm and presence whatsoever. He actually makes it to a level 3 ultimate. I mean, he's gonna get it soon, still. Imagine all those fights now with the earlier level 3 track. That might have, of course, made really a financial difference.
Now, Tongfu, multiple refresher orbs. Refresher Phoenix, refresher Quap. This is actually very scary. Very, very scary. Double supernova, double sonic wave.
Yeah.
Keep the fights going on for days.
Yep, absolutely. If he really gets it through. To be honest, the Queen of Pain, I actually thought she's going to go in a hex first, then sells the bottle, for example, and goes for the refresher. We saw that earlier in the round robin in this tournament. That is like sonic wave or hex sonic wave refresher. And then you wait, you hex him a second time. You can actually control someone for a very long time, like the Lashrak, against the BKB. But that's not coming out. But still, I think if he's going for another item and the game doesn't end till then, it's probably gonna be a hex. The hex is definitely gonna help the way the Queen of Pain finds initiations at the moment.
Well.
Oh, Rubik, you don't want to be there. They see him, there's initiation, but oh, instant reaction. Well, he's tracked, but he cannot really do anything against it. There's the BKB popped by both. That's the funny part, but the Phantom Lancer is joining the fray, and look at the damage just by the illusion. Hey, they try to clear it out. There's the lightning, and Rubik with the Shivas. There's just no way. Even the Queen of Pain, they have to run. So the gem is chopping, it's here, and they're happy to, like, yeah, conquer this one back. What did he just drop for it? I have no idea. But
he didn't drop anything, as far as I can see.
Okay, he had a free stock. Anyway, so with the Rubik being dead, but having a buyback, I guess it just tried to force the buyback maybe, going into mid, trying to get something on the tier 3 tower, or do they just push the lane in and then go for the other axe on the other side, because they are blank?
I honestly don't know. I think go for the easier target, but
yeah,
they've
they
got
go
the
for it.
Pressure right now on this middle lane from all of these creeps and two catapults. Hell, they'll split push both. That's what they need to do. There's Sonic Wave 1. It's a complete air ball. That's really not what you want. They need to get something here. They go for old chicken. Can they bring him down? Call down's there. Supernova as well. BKB's pop all the way across the board. And now, well,
that does
really
help.
It's a full disengage coming out of Energy Pacemaker, and that is a very wise call. That's
absolutely
the first supernova down.
Well, so the bottom line of this is buyback on the Rubik used, one Nova is being used, which means you force the Phoenix into using the refresher very much soon if they fight again. And, well, that is kind of bad. Also, the same situation for the Queen of Pain, but there, of course, the Aghanim Scepter, so Sonic Wave, Double Sonic Wave, would be ready right now.
Yeah, this is quite interesting. BKB timings, thank you, Corrupt. 5 seconds on Lesh, Quap and Gyro, 8 on the Knicks. Here we go, all over again. It's once again the Leshrac who's going to be first. He does get his BKB off, and everyone's trying to back out. Tong Fu trying to stand strong, but they've got to be... They need to disengage, and take a look at this. All of the MG Pacemaker guys are out and alive once again.
There's finally a Rocket actually following them up. Is that something they want to go for? That Rocket is on the Nexus S, and he's going to get stunned right there. But, well, it is even a stun on the Gyrocopter. Is there anything else coming? It doesn't really look like the Leshrac at the moment. Well, he heals up more with Octarine Core just by pumping that through that Creep Wave. They did some damage to the range tracks. The cliff has not been baited out, so they still have yet to break that cliff. And it seems like they go for a next round, but, well, we have Sonic Wave soon ready again. No, it is ready again, because he already used the refresher right there, and yet now there comes the cliff. They really want to force this. In the meantime, also bottom, the creeps are pushing in. Now there, they go for a new engagement. Actually, is that something where the Phoenix gets his egg in? No, it doesn't really look like it. Look at the Gyrocopter going full ham. Nice double Sonic Wave, but it's not enough damage. Look at the Leshrac just going ham. He's healing up so much. A new Creep Wave is even coming up. Yule Scepter protecting him. Buyback on the Gyrocopter. And now, well, the PL going full ham. Kabu is the next one to fall. He's going down. And, well, there's the lift. Actually, that could be a kill on the Phantom Lancer, but there's another. Yes, there is another Doppelganger, but there's also a Rocket following him. At the moment, he has nothing really to do against it. Is there another Sonic Wave? No. For another 16 seconds, he can't really do it. There is a Dazzler, however, taking care of this. And the turnaround on the Queen of Pain. Well, is that enough of the illusion? No, it's not. But they're gonna lose the Gyrocopter on the way. And that's, of course, really bad news, because that Gyrocopter, he is out for good. And that, I think, is a GG. Yes, that has to be a GG. What a game again. Energy Pacemaker, again, just more stamina and all this push.
Talk about an intense game.
Wow. I mean, we couldn't ask more of a best of five series, seriously.
No, we could.
We're damn tired, and yes, we miss a lot of things right now, but the fact is, it's just an amazing game. After 12 hours, I'm actually more awake than I started at 4 a.m. this night. So guys, thank you for watching. It's 2-1 for Energy Pacemaker, Tong Fu, okay.
You'll get that, Tong Fu.
Yeah, Tong Fu is actually the favorite team in this tournament, just by score, what they did before. Here, however, in the best of five scenario, EP suddenly remembering that they are a team that can surprise, and I'm very surprised right now, and I'm very amused. That is what pretty much the Queen would never say. So, that being said, and my little rant on my British co-caster, Mr. _ Blackadder, you can follow him, of course, on Twitter. We go in a game number 4, right?
Yeah, if this that's is a game 2-2, number 4. 2-1 in favor of Energy Pacemaker. If this goes to a full 5 series, this is going to be absolutely insane.
Absolutely amazing.
And it's rare ice swear when I'm casting.
Yeah. So guys, 5 minutes breaks. I guess that's what the teams mostly do, and then we go into game number 4. And let's see if that's the game side, because it's a match point for EP or Tong Fu. They might actually strike back. They're more than capable to do so. So be right back, guys.